Hey, hey, up, Rayvers. Yeah. Another request this week. We've had a request for this 1980s fantasy film by Terry Gilliam from the Monty Python lot. Yeah. Time Bandits. Yes, family adventure fantasy film, call it what you will. Time Bandits. Now, I've got very fond memories of Time Bandits, because Time Bandits were one of them films that I thought looked pretty good. I thought the kids will enjoy that. And you know what? They didn't want to go. Dean, my eldest, he were moaning because he wanted to go and see Clash at Titans. But I were a bit worried that there were some scary bits in that that were too scary for Maxine, my youngest. Maxine wanted to see Disney's Fox and the Hound, but there were no way Dean were going to go and watch that.
Look at that. A fox and a hound playing together.
So I got them each a lion's maid lolly and took them to see Time Bandits. Anyway, the film starts wheels zooming in to some suburban rat race housing estate. And we meet young lad Kevin, who's a history nerd, loves his history.
Did you know that the ancient Greek warriors had to learn 44 different ways of unarmed combat?
But his mum, who's Terry Collier's sister from the Lightly Lads, and his dad, who's Harry Crawford from Boone, they're just interested in material possessions.
Block of ice to beef bourguignon in 8 seconds. Lucky things.
Yeah, I love the fact they've still got the plastic on the sofa. Yeah, they don't want Kevin to shit it up with his muddy shoes right like that. Great touch, that. Now, it seems he's got a very overactive imagination, is Kevin, as he dreams about medieval knights on horseback romping round his bedroom. Except as we find out when his dad comes up to give him a bollocking, there ain't really been any knights on horseback in his bedroom, he's just imagined it all. But the next night, a band of dwarves, I've checked the terminology just to make sure I'm not using any offensive terminology, and I think dwarves is the right term, so yeah. A band of dwarves pops out of his wardrobe and he gets roped into an adventure, as him and the dwarves are chased by this supreme being thing, this hovering head. A bit like what you get in Zardoz.
Zardoz!
But they manage to escape through some sort of portal and find themselves transported to Napoleonic times. And it transpires that the band of dwarves are actually a load of robbers who have nicked a special map from the supreme being, which is why he's so knocked off with him. And this map is some sort of time map that shows them these portals which allowed to travel through time and space. And the band of robbers, led by David Rappaport, and featuring loads of folk who are robots and aliens in Star Wars and stuff like that, their plan is to bomb around time and space, robbing folk blind, and then buggering off through a time portal and never being able to get caught. Now, that'd be an ingenious plan, except for the small snag that they seem to be crap at it. But we do get to meet some famous historical figures and some weird and wonderful characters along the way, including Ian Holm as a Napoleon with a serious inferiority complex.
Alexander the Great, whose empire stretched from India to Hungary 1 inch shorter than me.
John Cleese is a very posh Robin Hood who comes across like one at Royal Family when they're on FA Cup final duty, making small talk with the teams before kick-off.
And you're a robber too, are you? How long have you been a robber?
4 foot 1.
Good Lord. Jolly good. 4 foot 1?
Yes.
Well, that is a long time, isn't it?
And Sean Connery plays Greek King Agamemnon. Although he's sort of mixed up a bit of history here, because in this timeline, he bumps off the Minotaur. Well, that weren't him, were it? But don't let that spoil your fun. And we see Grouty from Porridge as an ogre with a bad back. Very good. Really is good fun, this film. Now, throughout all these adventures, they're being observed by evil, played by the late, great David Warner. And evil wants this map for his sen, so he can use it to do evil stuff, whatever it is, I'm not sure. But he really is excellent as evil. Very evil, as you'd expect. And he can just exterminate folk with a waft of his hand. Be off with you. Boom. Yeah, his minions seem to like it, though. They seem to like being destroyed by evil. Yeah, Ringo from Never the Twain, he can't wait to be obliterated.
Oh, wonderful, Mars. Wonderful.
Well, I suppose it's preferable to being taken advantage of by Simon Peel and Oliver Smallbridge. They were a pair of unscrupulous bleeders, a pair of them. Hey, they both had brilliant voices though, didn't they? Donald Sinden had that dead posh, fruity voice. He'd sort of go, like that, wouldn't he? And Windsor Davies had that sort of deep bass Welsh voice, didn't he? Lovely voice. And he'd be there sort of going, oh, that wasn't very good, was it? Didn't sound very Welsh at all, did it? Sounded more sort of Bulgarian, if anything. Yeah. Now, in terms of child actors, I've got to say, this lad, he's really not very annoying at all, which is a rarity in child actors. Certainly nowhere near as annoying as the Ickle Turd from Outland. Oh, God, get him off. Oh, yeah, Connery hates him. You can tell he hates him. But Connery doesn't take this lad. He doesn't take Kevin. Although you'd think he'd ask why he's swanning around with a Polaroid camera in ancient Greece, wouldn't you? But, yeah, he doesn't seem to be bothered about that. In fact, to be honest, I'm surprised Connery's even in this film because he ain't a big role in it. Looks like it was filmed somewhere like Morocco. So maybe it's just because it was next door to a golf course or something like that. But yeah, Connery seems much more fond of Kevin than he were of his son in Outland. Despite Kevin seemingly being a bit of a bloodthirsty ickle bleeder.
There's a man being cut in half here. It must have been a brilliant battle.
Yeah, probably borderline psychopath. Sort of kid who enjoys pulling legs off spiders. Or use a magnifying glass to reflect the sun's rays on hot day and set fire to the cat's arsehole. But something that I think is very clever is when you meet Kevin at the beginning of the film and you see inside his bedroom, you see loads of stuff in there. What happens later in the film? There's clues. You know, he's reading a book about Greek heroes. There's Napoleon in the background. There's a picture of a galleon on his wall and a tank and loads of knights and all sorts. So it sort of foreshadows what happens later on in the film. Very clever, very clever. But I've got to point out, what on earth is that? What is that chap wearing? It looks like he's got some football shin pads on and some red and white striped underpants. I'm no history buff, but I am not aware of that being any period costume whatsoever. Anyway, at the end of the movie, Kevin wakes up in his bedroom with his house on fire. And it appears like it were all a dream, like he's imagined it all. As the firemen trample over his toy knights and his tanks, what we'd seen previously come to reality earlier in the film. But then he finds his Polaroids. And it weren't a dream. He's got proof. It were there in ancient Greece with Sean Connery. Who coincidentally happens to look exactly like this fireman. And just as you think things are getting a bit weird, Kevin's mum and dad explode after touching a piece of pure evil.
Mum! Dad! It's evil! Don't touch it!
So you're thinking, oh, is orphaned Kevin now going to get checked in by Sean Connery the fireman? Well, no, that would be very dodgy, wouldn't it? Complete stranger just checking in an orphaned young lad after he's just met him. You'd want the police involved there, wouldn't you? That would be ludicrous. Yeah, hard luck, Kevin. No happy endings here, fella. Although, to be fair, his mum and dad were awful. So maybe it's a blessing in disguise. Look, smoke coming out of the shoes. Classic. Okeydoo, on to Ray's ratings. Well, as I say, I thought this was going to be a good family film. I thought Dean would be happy with it. I thought Maxine would be happy with it. Even though both the ickle bleeders were moaning that they didn't got to see what they wanted to see. So I were hoping for a 3-star film. And guess what? Dean and Maxine bloody loved it. I were proved right. I felt like I'd got a nickel victory over the kids that day. And I were quite smug driving home. They loved it. Everybody were happy. So yeah, great fun, Time Bandits. I thoroughly recommend it as a great family film. So I'm rating Time Bandits a 4-star, 3-star film. Well, I thoroughly enjoyed watching that again, but yeah, it's getting late. Need to get back home in time for my tea. Well, I hope you enjoyed my review of Time Bandits, Rayvers. And if you did, poke the like button for me. Or maybe just gesticulate towards it like Evil does and just go boom and poke the like button that way. And remember to subscribe if you ain't already a subscriber to my channel. And share Ray reviews with your mates. Very much appreciated. And thanks for watching. And as always, thank you very much for your comments. Keep them coming. Love reading them. It's great to read them. And apologies if I don't get a chance to respond to them all, but thank you very much for those. And, copyright box permitting, I will be back with another review very soon. So I will see you next time. Okeydoo!